Hi, and welcome to A Slice of New York. I'm Mike Gilliam. Everybody's talking about artificial intelligence, but many of us aren't exactly sure what it is, or why we need it, or how to use it. And perhaps more importantly, in the long run, will it help us as a society or hurt us? So, we're on a mission to unravel the mysteries surrounding AI, why it's a big deal, how it fits into our lives, and some practical applications to make life easier. So as we kick off the new year, let's get to it. What is AI?
Artificial intelligence, and it's really helping a lot of people, a lot of departments, a lot of different industries, I would say.
What is AI?
Artificial intelligence, I believe.
But what is it?
I'm not sure. I don't know. That's cool.
How about you? What is AI?
It's a computer-based system which allows you to basically build algorithms that human beings would take a lot more time to do.
Do you use it at all?
No, not that I know of.
What do you think about artificial intelligence or AI?
I'm sort of mixed, honestly. I think it's useful, but I also think it's as useful as what you put into it.
Artificial intelligence, better known as AI, has been headlining the news for the past year. Wikipedia defines AI as the intelligence of machines or software, as opposed to the intelligence of humans or animals. It is a field of study in computer science which develops and studies intelligent machines. Such machines can be called AIs. Okay, so that wasn't all that helpful. So, we decided to ask AI and see if we could get a better answer. So we went to ChatGPT and asked the question, what is AI or artificial intelligence? The answer came back long, way too long. So we asked it to revise the answer. Just give me two sentences. AI or artificial intelligence is a field of computer science dedicated to creating systems that can perform tasks that typically require human intelligence, such as learning, reasoning, problem solving, and perception. These systems are designed to simulate human-like cognitive functions, enabling them to adapt and excel in various domains. So that was still kind of confusing. So we decided to ask it a third way. Can you explain AI so that a 10-year-old can understand it? Sure. Imagine you have a robot friend that you can teach to do things by showing it examples. For example, you can teach it to recognize apples by showing different pictures of apples. Nah, let's simplify. Okay, AI is like a brain for machines, making them smart. It helps them do things on their own, like talking or understanding pictures. People have to teach the machines what's good and bad, just like you learn from your teachers. So AI is like a smart helper in machines, and people are the teachers to keep them doing good things. Okay, so now that we're on a roll, I have some other questions. Can you control the world? No, I cannot control the world. I am a computer program created by OpenAI called ChatGPT, and I don't have any control over the physical world. And how about the money question? Can you make me money? I can provide information and advice, but I cannot directly make you money. Okay, but with any new technology, variables exist. And at this point, who really knows where all of this will go? Is there anything about it that concerns you?
Yes, I think I'd be pretty concerned about whether it kind of shifts the balance of the economy towards the people who create the AI technology, makes them richer, makes kind of wealth inequality a bit more dramatic, and whether governments really get a handle on how society is going to shift as a result of it and get ahead of that.
Joining me now, we have two experts who happen to also be CUNY professors. Anita Raja is a professor of computer science at Hunter College and the CUNY Graduate Center. And we have the founder and CEO of Qantm AI and an adjunct professor at Baruch College's Zicklin School of Business, Seth Dobrin. Thanks for coming in.
My pleasure. Thanks for having me.
Good to have you guys here. Anita, let's start with you. How would you define AI?
So I would define AI as the study of simulating or coming up with a system which is able to help with problem solving and decision support to make the users feel more comfortable and have easier lives.
Mm-hmm. How about you, Seth?
So in my mind, AI at this point is just a marketing term that encompasses a whole bunch of things, especially for consumers. It encompasses, you know, the mathematical and computer science aspects of it. It encompasses mathematical optimization. It encompasses what we call machine learning or predictive analytics. And now the new type of AI is generative AI that most people know around ChatGPT and tools like that.
Let's talk about ChatGPT. What is it and what does the GPT stand for?
Exactly, that's a really good question. So let's start with the second one first. So GPT stands for General Pre-trained Transformer. A transformer is a technology that was developed by Google in 2016, 2017. And ChatGPT, the technology underlying it, in this right now, GPT-4.
Now it's out there to many, many more people, correct?
It's out there to the world. I mean, 100 million users or million users in the first week. And it's a consumer. The big difference now is there's a consumer interface for it. So the general populace, the uneducated in this field, can actually go in and type through natural language. You know, anyone can ask it a question.
Mm-hmm. How are people using it, Anita?
So to answer queries, you know, so there are, you can interact with GPT or ChatGPT with using prompts, and you can ask questions about what is the best route to get from here to, you know, New Haven. You can ask about what is in the news, you know, in terms of what is happening with AI governance at the government level, or, you know, just ask, how do I make coffee? So what are my options to make coffee? So it has a range of answers for the questions that you can provide. I should also mention that my students can use it for help with understanding concepts and perhaps even with their homeworks.
I require my students to use it in my class.
I was going to kind of get into that. Has it really changed education per se?
It does help students learn better. So yes, I do allow students to use ChatGPT in my class, but they have to say how they used it. And, you know, because it can generate code, it can generate answers, but they also have to check whether the answers are correct. And that's not always a given. So the students should know enough to see if the answers are correct.
Yeah, and I look at this from a business perspective, right? Mm-hmm. When I bring new employees in, I expect them to know how to use the latest technology. I expect them to use it in their job. I always tell people I want lazy employees. Right, and I don't really want lazy employees, but I want employees that use every tool at their disposal to get a solution. I don't care how they get a solution. And so in my class, it's required. So every lesson you have to use generative AI. I tell them there is no such thing as cheating in this class. There's only plagiarism. And so the same as you, they have to tell me when they use generative AI.
But give me an example of how you might have them use it.
You can actually create PowerPoint slides using generative AI. And so I have them they have to do presentations, and all of the PowerPoint slides need to be generated, or at least started, using generative AI.
Mm-hmm. I have to say, I first started to really kind of get more interested in this and determined that it was more serious when a friend of mine said that he was talking to his younger son, a guy in his 20s or so, and the son said to him, "Hey, Dad, are you down with the AI? Do you understand this stuff? Because if you don't, you're going to be obsolete." Is that true?
It is true. You know, I think there's a quote from a famous radiologist. AI is not going to replace all the radiologists, but the radiologists who do not use AI are going to be replaced by radiologists who do use AI in their work, right? So it's an integrative part now of a lot of different enterprises. So from health to business models to education. So it is important to realize that this is going to help you, and that's also my North Star in my work. You know, so how do we build tools and systems which assist humans to have a better life, an easier life, given the amount of data and the computation that is available? So they're not replacing humans, as it were, mm-hmm. but making things easier and better.
I think there are use cases where you are going to replace humans. And you have to be very direct about that from a business perspective, saying the goal is to replace humans. Whether it's laying people off or getting them new jobs, or just through attrition, it's going to replace humans. So for instance, call centers. You may not get mass layoffs in call centers, but you are going to see a lack of backfills in those roles. And I also agree that you are going to have to use AI in the future in your job. It's going to be a requirement. Net overall, I think AI, the AI that we think about today, generative AI specifically, is going to create a lot of new jobs. Mm-hmm. But will it be like
when the steel industry left and all of a sudden, oh, sure, new jobs came, but the guys who used to do this aren't employed.
Exactly. So there's this transition period where there's going to be people that need to upskill, and there's going to be people that are, those career tracks are going to be decimated. Mm-hmm. So one that I predict is paralegals. Generative AI can do a lot of the research that paralegals can do. You don't need as many paralegals. You need paralegals that can validate the information, that can synthesize it, that can then convert it to the way it needs to be, personalize it for their firm. And I think we need to be very mindful of that. And the big difference between the steel worker, so the industrial revolution, if you will, the industrial revolution took three and a half generations. Mm-hmm. So it had plenty of time for all these steel workers to get retrained, for all these communities to kind of rebuild around a different industry. This is going to happen in less than 10 years. This transition is going to be less than one generation where you're going to see people that are out of work, both blue collar, so both lower skilled jobs, medium skilled jobs, and even high skilled jobs. And so we need to figure out how we're going to address this. And it behooves us as universities, in the case of CUNY, but also businesses need to invest in employees because those employees have invested in them for a long time, most of them.
Mm-hmm. You know, when I talked to people on the street, some of them did say they were afraid of this.
They
thought that they're going to lose jobs. I'm sorry?
They should be.
Okay. Well, I do want to give the other slant, so thank you, Seth. But I think AI is already here. It has been in our lives for a while. Perhaps we didn't recognize it. So an example would be recommendation systems, right? So when you log on to a movie site like Netflix or mm-hmm. YouTube, you see a set of movies at the bottom, like the top five that you might be interested in watching, right? And this has been around for a while. And that is machine learning and AI that is the engine behind that.
And generative AI is making a shift where now there's a broader application of uses that are more intuitive, that are better, right? Mm-hmm. We've had natural language processing, which is what generative AI is a type of, but that's when you call up your bank and you go, agent, because it's horrible. Mm-hmm. This technology is a technology that people are gonna wanna talk to instead of a human for a lot of instances. And so you're gonna see a huge shift in the use of AI and adoption by consumers.
Is that why people should be afraid of it?
Well, I think people should be afraid of it for a couple of reasons. One is replacing jobs and the transition. So everyone needs to start educating themselves to what Dr. Raja said. Everyone needs to start educating themselves around how they incorporate AI into their jobs, into their daily life. That's really important. There are some other aspects that we really need to be scared of. So the core technology, right? When you think about what generative AI is at its core, it's math and computer science that's trained on data. Now, the way generative AI, specifically large language models and these video models that are called diffusion models, they hallucinate for a living. It's just a matter of how accurate the hallucination is. And if you define hallucination as making something up, some of the hallucinations are factual based on the data that they're trained on, and some of the hallucinations have no basis in fact. And then you have the ethics of it. So how was the data procured that's training these models? Is it respecting privacy laws? Is it respecting us as human beings? Is it extending the social, socioeconomic divide and the global digital divide? There's all these ethical questions that come up when you start looking at the underlying technology and who's building it. It's primarily white, middle-aged and young white and Indian men that are building this technology. There is very little representation from the black and brown community. There is very little representation, although it'd be a little better, of women. And so you have people designing tools that have no concept of what it's like to be a user from those groups, from those demographics. Dan.
Do you also see this driving wealth inequality?
These tools are being developed primarily in the U.S. and in China, a little bit in the Middle East. Mm-hmm. North of the equator, all these tools are being developed. And they are being developed for a set of users and a set of people who are impacted by it. And they're sometimes the same person, sometimes different people. So different people is an example of a mortgage. Mm-hmm. The mortgage broker and underwriter are using AI to tell whether or not you should get a mortgage, so you're the one that's impacted. Netflix, Amazon, those are where you're both the user and the impacted. If people are building these AI that are not representative of the communities that they're going to be deployed in, you are going to widen that divide. You are going to increase bias. You are going to increase misinformation. And you're not going to necessarily solve a real problem for those communities. Now, that brings up a whole lot of technical aspects of how you would do this and manage it globally. But the net of it is, if all these models are built in the West, and they are built to our morals and our ethos, we are effectively developing or forcing our ethos on the rest of the world.
Mm-hmm. One quick question here. How can a novice get involved in AI? What's the best way to go ahead and start to get your feet wet and start to use this technology, aside from just Netflix or Amazon?
So, you know, again, you're already using it. When you deposit a check electronically and it's doing handwriting recognition, that was one of the first applications for AI, you know, because people have different handwritings and it's able to figure out what you have written. And I think interaction with large language models like ChatGPT allows you to get information that you need. Uh-huh. Another application that I can say is smart homes. How do you use the thermostat, like Nest and so on, to adjust your temperature in the house so that when you come back from the office, that it knows this is the time you're going to get back, you should start the heat up at this time, and so on. So it's already happening.
There's two aspects to this in my mind. So there's what I call old school AI, which is pre-November 2022, which is all machine learning, predictive analytics. Yeah. And the new school of AI, which is generative AI, ChatGPT-like technologies. And I think the best way to learn how to use the technology is to use it. There's lots of videos and blogs and things like that on the web. But there's two ways that you're going to consume this. So one is in tools. So ChatGPT, Microsoft Office has all their co-pilots. You have Google that's integrated in. Adobe has Firefly. I mean, there's all sorts of tools that we're using every day, and we may or may not realize we're using generative AI. But as employees and as participants in society, we need to use it in our lives as well, because there are going to be times where we're going to want to use it outside of those tools. Plus, it always helps us to understand how a technology works if we're going to use it, even if it's at a very basic level. So I think, you know, use it is net, or take my class, one of the two.
Okay. So basically, our feet are already wet.
We're right, Alexa, Siri, and so on, right?
Exactly.
So these are AI in your lives.
Okay, yeah. I'm all out of time, okay? But I do want to thank you both, Anita Raja, a professor of computer science at Hunter College and the CUNY Graduate Center, and Seth Dobrin, the founder and CEO of Qantm AI, a strategic advisory firm and an adjunct professor at Baruch College's Zicklin School of Business. Thank you. When we come back, AI is not only changing our day-to-day world, it's also impacting the art world. Up next, we're talking with a curator of an art exhibit in the city that is truly amazing. Wait till you see this. I'm Mike Gilliam, and this is a slice of New York. It's called Artechouse. It's an exhibit in Chelsea that's using AI, and I have to tell you, it's something to behold. Just amazing. Joining me to tell us all about it is Rio Vander Stahl, Artechouse's Director of Digital Strategy. Rio, welcome.
Thank you so much.
Good to have you in here. Tell me, what is it?
So this exhibition, what's really interesting about this exhibition is that it is a story about imagination, about creativity. Uh-huh. And we've used AI to create it. So AI is very much part of the framework, but this exhibition shows you how AI can be used in a way that really elevates an experience. It creates a new kind of visual journey.
Uh-huh. Let's put it up here on our monitors here, and you just kind of describe for me what it is we're actually seeing here.
So we're seeing a still, and it's important to note that, because this immersion gallery, as we call it, it is at our Chelsea Market location, and it is an old converted boiler room. A little snapshot of what is a really incredibly detailed and incredibly sort of transformational visual scene that the Artechouse Studios created.
Yeah, but it's more than just like looking at artwork on a wall or on a pedestal though, right?
It is. So one of the things that, you know, that we do at Artechouse is we've been pioneering and pushing how you experience art. And we do that by working with artists and doing, you know, developing work ourselves, using technology to create. So technology and what the next thing is always on our minds. So our founders thought of this, you know, what's the next thing in art? Being able to stand in it, being able to have it surround you, not just being able to look at it on a wall, but being able to live in it and sit in it and dance and run and be around it. And so, you know, this exhibition itself, this experience really wraps you in the visuals and the power of this sort of creative storytelling. Uh-huh. But then throughout the exhibition, there are also other interactive installations that let you play around with some of these techniques and models.
But I have to ask you, what's involved in creating this? How do you create it?
So the creative process is really incredible. So we, Artechouse Studio is our in-house team of creatives, the coders, developers, architects. They do pretty much everything that we put out there. Uh-huh. And they worked with NVIDIA and NVIDIA Research, and they developed these custom pipelines to be able to work at an incredibly fast speed working with these generative AI models. Mm-hmm. And their goal as they sort of set out on this project was, we think about productivity a lot. We think about how it can improve our lives, how it can make writing a paper faster, research faster.
Right.
They were thinking about it, well, what if we thought about AI not as artificial intelligence, but artificial imagination? And how can we use this technology and develop it so that it's a creative collaborator for us? And so they worked with NVIDIA, they developed these custom pipelines, and they ended up producing over 1 million sort of data points, meaning still images, videos, information that helps to create what you're seeing.
So someone's sitting at a keyboard doing this?
Normally, to do this kind of work, you'd have to be a coder. You have to be a computer science, familiar with that whole world. But they developed their own interface to allow them to change parameters to, you know, basically on a computer, be able to say, give me this, and then have the system generate it. And so over the course of that, developing more than a million different assets, they ended up settling on what it is that we have in the exhibition.
So if I go there, what is it I'm going to experience?
So if you go there, I think like one of the things that I love the most about Artechouse is that we create experiences that are many layers. So as you walk in, you are going to be sort of immersed into a story that doesn't have words, but is a visual and an audio story inspired by imagination, inspired by creativity. It itself isn't a story about AI. But as you spend more time, as you learn, as you ask questions, as you really have a chance to let all of it sink in, you get a chance to begin uncovering layers, beginning to think about, how is AI used in this? Oh, each one of these components also includes AI. So when you go, the experience itself really is what you want to make of it. Plus, we also have an XR bar, which features our own cocktails that all have an art element to them that are all inspired by the exhibition, but makes a great, great date night, great sort of event, if you want.
What's been the response?
The response has been really interesting. So I think that AI is such a charged word. It's so topical right now.
Right.
And as a result, there's so much conversation, there's so many opinions that people have formed about it. What's really interesting is that we've actually found from talking to people that they feel like the exhibition might not be relevant to them. It might not be something that they would be interested in. Mm-hmm. But what is so unique about the studio is that they always create work that is really approachable.
See, I mean, I'm sure there's some who are in the so-called art world who would say, well, wait a minute, how can this be art if you're not putting paint to canvas or drawing?
I think that that's a fair question. I think I would ask the question, what do they think about when the computer was rolled out? Mm-hmm. Or when, every generation has had a different kind of technology that really vaults us forward, that becomes representative of a huge shift in the creative process for art, but also for, business in any other field. And for us, we think that that's AI and computer power. And so I think it is not necessarily a question of if AI is real art, but it's how are we using AI within the creative process to create art that is really inspiring, engaging, and interesting for people.
So where do you see this sort of artwork going in the future?
Well, I think that this artwork, we can see that it is going to become even more available for you at home. So it's going to be a lot easier for someone to get access to these tools to be able to create. It's going to make a lot of people into artists who may not have thought that they were artists, which I think is incredible. I think we're going to see more larger scale. We're going to see things rapidly sort of improve and increase and just, you know, general accessibility. But I think one of the other important components of that is that AI and these generative tools are all data-based, meaning they all take in information to learn what they do. And so it's important that, we were talking about bias earlier, for people to be involved because they're learning now. So being involved, having it, you know, inputting what it is that your perspective and your point of view from an art perspective, from any perspective, is really important because we're training what it's going to look like for the next 5 years, 10 years, and into the future.
Yeah, because we really don't know, right?
Yeah, we don't.
Okay, Rio, that's going to have to do it. Our thanks to Rio Vander Stahl from Artechouse. Now, we hope that we've helped to shed a little bit of light on AI, making it just a little bit more approachable, a little less scary, and maybe even a bit of fun. I'm Mike Gilliam. We'll see you next time on A Slice of New York.